450.
Another day and another landmark judgment. A five-judge constitution bench of the Supreme Court has decriminalized adultery by striking down a law that was over 150 years old. So far, a man who had sexual relations with a married woman could be imprisoned for adultery only if the act was without the consent of her husband. Effectively, the law treated women as property of their husbands. Now, adultery remains grounds for divorce, but is no longer a criminal act. To speak on the implications of this judgment, I'm joined by two top dynamic Supreme Court lawyers, Karuna Nundy and Aishwarya Bhati. Welcome to both of you, and thank you for speaking with us today. Karuna, I want to also look at this in the context of the kind of judgments we've seen in the last few weeks. Section 377, of course. We've seen this order on adultery, and the fight for marital rape still continues.
I think you've narrowed down the issue quite well and quite specifically, because if you look at all of these cases, one of the main issues that they turned on was a very, very important legal principle in the criminal law, right? Which is consent, which is that I have a right to bodily integrity and you have a right to bodily integrity. And that is the basis on which dealings with my body and your body should function. This was, of course, another an underlying principle of Aadhaar as well, but we leave that aside for a minute. But in sexual relations, in 377, for instance, you know, unnatural carnal intercourse against the order of nature, it had nothing to do with consent, which is why, one of the major reasons why it's been read down. Then you also have the in adultery. You see, it was sort of very, it was problematic and sexist in a number of different ways. So one aspect that you pointed out was that when a woman, when somebody's wife goes and has an affair, it's not that he had an action against her, because after all, she's the one who made the bond, etc., right? But it's not that there was any criminal action against her, though I would disagree with that as well. The criminal action was against the person that she had an affair with.
Yeah.
And also, if he had the affair with someone, she could not bring a criminal action either against him or against the person that he cheated with, right? So you see where all of this is coming from. All of this is really coming from the old English doctrine of coverture, which is that a woman is a man's property. Now, the marital rape case, which I am arguing in the High Court, is as in we are seeking the strike down of the the marital rape exception. So it's rape unless you are married to the person. It could be however brutal it is, it doesn't matter, it's not rape, right? And the largest percentage of rapes happen in the context of marriage, right? So when we talk about rape and we're very upset about rape in this country and we're trying to do something about it, the large percent, you know, the majority of rapes are actually legal. So how does this relate? Well, it's the same, it comes from the same doctrine of coverture, that a woman is a man's property. So that when you get married, then of course she's going to have, she has to have sex with you. So then how can it be rape? That's the thinking that it comes from. So the adultery judgment is along the same bright line of consent that we are seeking to bring into the law in the context of marital rape as well. And the entire criminal law needs to be organized along these principles rather than stemming from the ridiculous old Victorian nonsense that has been overruled in England.
Okay.
And many other Commonwealth countries.
Absolutely. Aishwarya, I want to come in with, you know, the various kind of reactions we're seeing today. Those who understand this and perhaps have gone to some details of the judgment have lauded it. Those who are looking at it very quickly, perhaps from some news flashes, are some of them are jumping to the conclusion that this is a license to adultery and what is happening to the moral fabric of our country. Does that also show the dichotomy of the society we live in?
Tamanna, I think, you know,
without understanding if comments like these are being made, then I think we need to make this judgment, decipher this judgment better, and we need to make people understand that adultery continues to be a civil wrong. It continues to be a matrimonial wrong. Therefore, for all reasons, for all issues like divorce, maintenance, alimony, custody, all of these issues, domestic violence, cruelty, adultery will continue to be a wrong. The only thing that has been done by the Constitution bench is that it is not a crime anymore. And please understand how the section was. It was not just that it was unequal in man and woman. It was premised on the principle that a woman is a chattel of a man. And if you had a sexual intercourse with a man's wife, with his consent and connivance, that's what the section read, with his consent and connivance, then it was not adultery. And if a man had sexual intercourse outside of his marriage with an unmarried girl, then it was not adultery. Now, the way adultery is understood in a matrimonial wrong, in a civil wrong, is very, very different. Any sexual activity outside of the marriage is understood to be adultery. That is how it has to be. Now, you spoke about how these kind of judgments are coming from Supreme Court and how the trend seems to be changing. I want to highlight that this judgment equally, signifies it's a pathfinder, it's a milestone, and it also somewhere chronicles the journey of the Supreme Court itself. This very section of adultery has met with scrutiny of the Supreme Court earlier also, at least one time by a bench headed by the senior Justice Chandrachudu's father of Justice D.Y. Chandrachudu's, one of the authors of the judgment today, and the Supreme Court found it to be perfectly legal and constitutional. Now, it's interesting because Supreme Court in one of the judgments has also said that fundamental rights are like empty vessels and every generation needs to fill those empty vessels with its own wisdom. So it's great to see that this wisdom of the current time, the wisdom of this generation, is being reflected in the journey of the Supreme Court also. It is a very significant step. It's not like adultery was...
I just wanted to ask you, Aishwarya, do you agree with the point that Karuna made, that the next step from what we've seen in 377 and the adultery law being struck down, the next logical step is to marital rape?
Well, I am not a biggest proponent of criminalizing marital rape. My personal views are not in that favor. I feel that having too many laws in a matrimony is like, we have a saying that have too many laws in the marriage is like having a bull in the china shop. Surely, I mean, who knows, maybe not right now generation, maybe the wisdom has come, and maybe it's, what I'd really like to see sometime is that rape itself becoming gender neutral. Why should sexual harassment and rape be gender centric at all? So it's a long journey. That is the ultimate goal of the journey. Marital rape, we'll see when the time comes for it to debate. I am personally not for it. I think the time is not ripe for marital rape to be criminalized.
This brings me to another point and a larger point, Karuna, which is how the Supreme Court seems to be passing judgment on, let me say, sticky issues which deal with a society and the way people view individuals. And these are all issues that political parties, MPs, MLAs do not want to touch. Politicians don't want to legislate on these issues, and this tough job, so to speak, has been left to the Supreme Court.
Look, first I want to, Aishwarya is of course a warm colleague in court and all that, but there are a number of issues that I disagree with. For example, that the time is not right. Now, the time is never right for women's rights. The time is never right for women's freedoms, rather. This is why the courts exist. The courts exist because whether the time is right or not, whether a politician feels that it is a popular move or not, the court exists to guarantee the fundamental rights and the bodily integrity and freedoms of each individual. Now, when we speak of marital rape, and it is said that we shouldn't have too many laws in the bedroom, are we also saying that if a husband kills his wife, that's too much of a law in the bedroom? That if a husband slaps his wife, then that's a law in the bedroom? Then or you know, tortures her in a non-sexual way, all of which is, you know, criminal, of course. That these are laws that should not be in the bedroom? Should a husband be able to do anything he likes, you know, in terms of violence, non-consensual violence to his wife because it's in the bedroom? No. So when slapping is criminal and when murder is criminal, why is rape non-criminal? Now, in terms of your question about the political parties, some of the political parties have started to realize that the wind is blowing elsewhere, that women have started voting in larger numbers, that women are, that people in general are, that there's a significant enough percentage of people, for example, that wanted the striking down of 377, wanted to get rid of 377. So we had the Congress, for instance, take a very clear stand on this. And I think that they should be lauded because this was a leadership position. Many other people fell into line after. But nobody passed, and, you know, Shashi Tharoor did float a private member's bill. But nobody passed the legislation. And let's keep in mind, when the UPA was in power, they could have done so. They say that it was sub judice, they could have still passed the law. Why? Now, the thing is that nobody wants to take that risk, that it's not popular enough, that it's going to get a backlash, that the conservative populace is going to react and that they're not going to get elected. But whether it's a difficult job or not, if the governments and political parties fail to act in accordance with constitutional principles and go for populist demands for oppression or violence or whatever, to allow oppression and violence, then the court has to act, you know?
Yeah.
And it is very much the court's job as well.
I want Aishwarya to answer that question, and I have a sense that she wants to respond to Karuna as well. But let me put that question to you as well, Aishwarya, that this is also a sign of how the Supreme Court is having to step in and, in a sense, do a part of the job that politicians could. We've heard not as much enthusiasm and, in some cases, silence from top political leaders on Section 377 on adultery. No one is really talking much about it, not with the same gusto that triple talaq was, you know, spoken about. So is there a fear or risk of losing votes, like Karuna says?
No, I think, Tamanna, these are issues which are almost like dirty linen issues. They are not significant from the democracy's point of view, from a populist point of view. Therefore, they are not priorities. They may not, you know, politicians would have a stand on a lot of these things, but they're just not priorities in a democracy. And since it's not, it's the vote bank politics which, fortunately and unfortunately, governs the democracy of the country. Therefore, dirty linen is always the job of the courts. But let's not also forget that has been the case always. I mean, even when Supreme Court stood up to protect the dignity of women in Shabano's case by saying that even Muslim women are entitled to maintenance, the government of the day had to bring in a law. I mean, they did bring a law to completely negate the benefits that had come out from the Shabano's case. A uniform civil code is a sterling example of how courts have been time and again saying that, you know, it's in the directive principle of the Constitution. Uniform civil code has to be brought in. It's just not priority. Nobody seems to be working. And these issues, interestingly, they get shelved at, you know, law commissions or various other commissions with expert bodies, seemingly expert bodies. So, but I must also point out, if you remember the Nas judgment of the Supreme Court, on the first instance, even the Supreme Court did not reverse the Bombay High Court's judgment on the reasoning saying that it's a minuscule minority and therefore the Supreme Court need not look at this issue. It was only when privacy was enshrined by a 9-judge constitution bench unanimously as a fundamental right. And then, you know, the foundation was laid there itself in Justice Chandrachud's majority judgment that even if it's a minuscule minority, even if it's one person whose fundamental right is violated, that has to be seen. So it is a journey, you know, these things are not static. It is a very dynamic journey. I think on the issue of marital rape, I will humbly, have to disagree with my wonderful colleague Karuna. But I personally feel that, where the relationship itself, sexual activity is the foundation or one of the basic ingredients, fundamental ingredients of a relationship. Therefore, the dangers in criminalizing that sexual activity is far graver. But I say, having said that, I humbly agree to disagree with her on this, and we leave this debate for another day. Today is a great day. It's a huge milestone. Decriminalizing adultery is a huge step, and it's definitely going to be a milestone in gender equality.
Absolutely. We leave it there. I think everyone agrees, at least on this panel, that decriminalizing adultery is a step towards gender equality. The question still remains why can our politicians not step up to the plate and leave the tough job to the Supreme Court? Thank you so much for joining us.